10. I opened it. I was still selling cars. I had a customer that says, you know, you're really good at this. Every experience we've ever had with salespeople has been horrible. You should teach salespeople to do what you do. So that was kind of my inspiration right there, as a customer kind of called me out on it. So I went and got my LLC. I trademarked Conquer What You Chase. That's what I live by. Conquer what you chase. Conquer what you chase. So that's what I live by. That's my mantra. My name's Noel Walsh, like I said. I'll go over to the next slide right here. So my favorite quote, the quote I wrote, is when you inspire people, you will bring out the very best they can be, and they will give you the very best they have. Now, I've got an online virtual training, and it's called Conquer You, and the two things I talk about the most is process and culture. And I think that's two things that we lack in this business. I talk to salespeople all the time. They have a very ineffective process. Dealerships have a very ineffective process. And the culture in the store with the salespeople, between the salespeople amongst each other, between sales and management, between sales and leadership, and between the dealership and customers really lacks culture. You know, we need to inspire our customers to want to buy off us. We need to inspire our customers to want to invest in us. We need to inspire our customers to want to help our family live the good life, to want to see the pictures on our phone of going up north, going to Canada, going fishing, going to Disney. That's what we want to do. We want to inspire our customers to want to be part of our story. A little background about me is I have been in the business for 18 years. I believe one of you were saying the same thing. I consider myself a dealership brat. My dad was a salesman, sales manager, GM, GSM, used car manager, worked for AutoNation, big Ford stores, dealerships all over the country. And when I was about 7, 8 years old, I'd call my dad up on the late nights. We came out to Michigan for the summer, and I'd call my dad up on the late nights, and I'd ask him, how many so-and-so got out? How many's Nick got out? Why's Nick only up 2 out? Nick did 10 on Friday and Saturday. Why's he only got 2 out? What's his problem? You know, so I grew up in the business that way. When I was 14, 15, 16 through high school, I would work in the prep department, work as a porter in the dealership, knew all the salespeople. I was a horrible student. I didn't do 5 years in high school like Fran said, but I only went to school about half of the time through high school because I saw what my dad was able to create in the car business, and I knew that the opportunity was always there, so I could kind of slack off a little bit because I knew that the opportunity was there. Probably not the best thing, but it made me good. So I sold over 3,000 cars. I made over $2 million in commissions. Been in the business 18 years, 16 years selling, 6 years training, 2 years in the wash rack. And through Ford for 7 years, I made the E2, Employee Excellence. If any of you are Ford guys, that's the highest rating that Ford gives. I was level 3. I did never make level 4. There was a couple people in my region that were just doing massive amounts of vehicles. But I was level 3. There's only like 4 people in each region that got level 4. I was level 3 every year, and I did carry 100% satisfaction through the Ford customer satisfaction, through the employee excellence on Q1 and Q7, which Ford looked at the most, overall sales experience and salesperson overall. I made sure that they had a great experience and that they loved me as a salesperson. So that's a little bit of a background on me. So what I wanted to do on this one, I told Fran, he's like, what are you talking about? Why don't you just talk about leasing? Leasing's your thing. I know a lot about sales. I worked at a store where we did everything cradle to the grave. If you follow a lot of these websites, online sources, Facebook, everybody's talking about a cradle to the grave process. Both stores I worked at did a cradle to the grave. I was a salesperson. I was a sales manager. I was the F&I manager, and I was the porter, right? So I did my own numbers. I sold my own back end, and I paired my own phone. So we did everything from start to finish. The process took longer, but it was more effective, and guess what? The customers never forgot me and appreciated me for everything because I was there from start to finish, then go from me to Jerry to Susie to the lot boy, and then forget, who's that salesperson? I don't know, he's a nice guy. He was really, really nice and genuine. So we did everything from the cradle to the grave, A through Z. And so what I'm talking about this is it's selling cats and retaining dogs. So what Anthony was talking about, and I think this was a good lead, a good follow-up from Anthony, is selling cats is getting that fresh lot customer, that phone lead, that internet lead, that customer who's shopping online, right? They're a stray cat. They have no affinity to us. They have no loyalty to us. They've been shopping 10 other dealerships online also. What they are looking for is they are looking for engagement, right? They start out, they're just looking for the lowest price, the best deal, who's got the right vehicle. And, you know, the average car dealership will see between a 20 and 30% closing sold ratio on customers who step foot in the dealership to buy a vehicle. So if they step foot, I've heard anywhere from 18 to 23. I looked at a bunch of different figures when I put up this PowerPoint. And so I'm going with 20 to 30%, depending on what region, depending on what kind of customer you have, new or used. And, you know, customers, also a funny fact I found, that when they do touch base on the dealership, they are 80% likely to buy that day. So when we're letting customers walk on trade, or we haven't showed them enough value, they're 4 out of 5 chances they're going to buy something that day from our competitor, because we didn't provide enough value, we didn't get them excited enough, we didn't show that we cared enough, we didn't really earn or accommodate their business to the level that they felt trusting to give us their business. And so the key is to getting the stray cats from online inquiries and incoming calls. And what you have to do is you have to engage them in conversation. Anthony shared some great pointers. You have to get them engaged, because they've got the same conversation going on with 9 other Shannons, you know, with 9 other Nicholases. They've got the same conversation going on with other dealerships. So the way we get ahead of the crowd is we have to create engagement. We have to respond quickly. We have to engage with them. We have to empathize with them. We have to get them excited. We have to be enthusiastic, because we have to set ourselves ahead of the crowd. We have to show that we are the cream of the crop, because otherwise it's all going to come down to price. It's all going to come down to the best vehicle. You know, Anthony had 14 hours. I've heard as much as 40 hours of true research from the time. I mean, because when do they start shopping their new car? Right after they buy one, right? They're kind of getting online, and, ooh, I really like this Infiniti next, and, hey, honey, what about the Mercedes for the next one? So it's a long ongoing process, but the customer has a lot of time invested. We need to consider that. That's your regular Henry Ford work week that they have invested in shopping for a car, between talking about it with family and friends, going online, looking at dealerships after hours, and different things of that nature. So we have to get that customer engaged, and we're usually going to have to do this before they enter the dealership. And then there's the dog, the loyal puppy dog, right? And this is the customer who gives us repeat and referral business. So we want to put out that saucer of milk and gain that stray cat, right? We've got to put out that value proposition that brings them in, that makes them want to deal with us, that shows that we are different and we are the cream of the crop. We're better than our competition. We're more thorough. We're more knowledgeable. We're more professional. So we put out that saucer of milk. We were able to bring that stray cat in. These are the customers that we all desire as salespeople, managers, and all departments in our dealership. Our closing ratio doubles, right? Our commissions go up 40 to 50%. And they cost the dealership on average $500 less per customer, right? They're an organic customer. Yeah, they did see some of our ads. They saw our billboards. They went to our website. But we spent $500 less in advertising to bring that customer in. So it's truly a win-win for everybody, because with referral and repeat business, the reputation is already built, so it makes it that much easier to build the rapport. And those customers who are referral and repeat customers are also more likely to use all our departments, right? Our service department, our body shop, our parts department, our aftermarket department. They get more inclined with the products that we sell in finance, and they start to see value in those. So they're really a win-win-win for all the departments. Now, one thing that I see a lot of salespeople do is they sell a customer, and I was talking with dealers all day yesterday, GMs and managers, they sell a customer, and let's say it's a used vehicle, and there was a nick in the wheel, or there's something wrong with the vehicle. So they're afraid to call that customer back, right? Because they're afraid they're going to hear, they're thinking chargeback. They're afraid they're going to hear the customer complain. They're afraid to call that customer back. So what are they doing? They're out there looking for a new customer, right? They're looking for another stray cat. Rather than taking care of the puppy dog and raising it up, they're looking for another stray cat. And we all know the stats on that, that we're just creating harder work. I mean, this is everything that Fran talked about, Chris, Anthony. It's when we've sold those customers, they obviously trust us enough to do business with us. They like our product enough to buy it. And they feel comfortable in our dealership. So that's truly who we need to focus on, is our previous customers and extracting referrals from them. And we do that by prospecting. We do that by staying engaged, keeping in touch. So we really want to stay on top of those, because like Yeah, he hates going after fresh ups, right? He despises it. He's not afraid to make 200 phone calls in a day, but he does not like getting that fresh up. So what we want to do is we want to coddle and engage with the customers we've sold. I had the opportunity to watch Nick work the other day. I was at his dealership half a Monday. He met me at Bob Evans at 8 in the morning. We hung out most of the day. And this guy's a horse. I mean, this guy goes right to it, right from the get-go. He's getting me coffees. He's introducing me to GMs and sales managers, and I'm giving meetings. And, you know, but the guy still is just on his process. So what he's doing is he's going after all his leads. He's doing all his follow-ups. So he's going after the stray cats. But he's also still taking care of the dogs in the backyard, right? The dogs in the pen. And they don't turn into repeat and referral business until we engage those online phone inquiries and create enough value so they feel confident doing business with us. So they don't just all become repeats and referrals just because that's the business we all want. We have to create that. So we have to remember that when we have a customer, not to skip steps to the process, to thoroughly be engaged with that customer on the conversation, to be in their presence, to look them in the eyes, to shake their hands, to ask them questions, to get them to talk about what they like. I was talking about from family, recreation, occupation, money. When we talk about, we find out if they're a family person, right? I've been divorced, I can't stand them. Well, we don't talk about family. Recreation, oh yeah, we love going water skiing, my kids in hockey, my daughter does dance, we travel across, you know, you bring up that, you find out what they like to talk about. They don't do either of those, but occupation. They love work, right? I'm a surgeon, I went to school for 14 years. Get them to talk about what they want, then we're able to get them to talk about money, right? So we've got to find out family, recreation, occupation, what their hot button is, listen, engage with them in conversation, then they're comfortable to talk with us about money. So that's one way to definitely engage them right there. They have to feel comfortable to do business with us. So here's my breakdown right here. So the truth about selling cats and retaining dogs. So the stray cat responds to customers online and phone questions and inquiries quickly with the answers they desire. If you don't, your competition will. If a customer calls and says, hey, what's the interest rate on a Honda Civic? You know, what's the interest rate on a new Honda Civic? You have to come in and talk to my finance manager. It's all over online. Mm-hmm. Why wouldn't you say as low as 1.9%? Mm-hmm. When can you make it in? And when we aren't giving these customers the information they want, guess what? They're going to call and their competition's going to. Mm-hmm. I heard Nicholas doing this yesterday. Well, it varies for, you know, a variety of different reasons it varies, but it could be from this to this. We have to give them some kind of answer because that's what they want, and they've seen all this online. They just want to verify that it's true. So as low as 1.9%, when can you make it in? You know, and you can use a little bit of Anthony's phone skills. His are a little bit sharper than mine. But, you know, we want to bring them in, and we have to answer their question, because if we don't give them an answer on anything, you know, what's the price on this truck? Well, it says call for details. Well, you have to come in to get the price. You know, we have to give them the basic information that's pretty much out there anyways, or else we are no value to them. They're going to find competition that will. You can't give away the farm either. You can't answer all their questions. It'd be a data dump, information overload, because now you are no longer needed, right? You gave them everything they need, so now they're going to take all that information and take it to the next guy. So we want to give them what they're initially looking for, but we can't give away the farm. We can't give them too much information. And keep the customer engaged with us in the dealership, right? So send them a follow-up email, text, what have you. Thanks for your phone call. I'm glad you're interested in our 2016 Chevy Silverado. I've got one with the Z71 too. I guarantee if you buy this vehicle, you're going to love it. I love mine. I was apprehensive about a truck. Keep them engaged. So then the house cat. So this is where we built enough value and trust in ourselves, our product, and the dealership that they feel comfortable and they're ready to set an appointment with us and to come in. Right? So they were a stray cat, there's that lead. Now we want to make them a house cat. We want to bring them in. And so this is where we get them to trust us. We didn't give too much information over the phone or online, but what we did is answer the customer's basic questions and brought the customer into our showroom and in to touch, feel, see, smell the product, right? Everybody, what's your manager always say? Did they test drive yet? Did they test drive yet? Did you get them in the car? Did you get them in the car? I sold Ford with 34 dealerships within 30 miles and 8 Ford plants within 40 miles, right? A third of my customers worked for Ford, or their spouse did. So what do you think they all told me when I said, let's take a test drive? I don't need to take one, I build them. Or I'm selling them their fifth Explorer. I don't need to drive one. This is my fifth one. You know, but we need to get them behind the wheel because we do need to sell the sizzle and get them excited about the product, because otherwise it's just a window sticker print off and it's numbers, right? So there's no emotional bond there. There's no excitement. So we need to get them behind the wheel. We need to get them to drive it. And once we get them in, show them our product, give them a dynamite presentation. So now the puppy dog, this is where we make the sale. Everyone's happy, right? The customer got their new vehicle. They researched, drove, and they bought. The salesperson, BDC, managers, the whole dealership's happy. Everyone got a sale. Everyone's excited. The customer's excited. We're posting pictures on social media. We're following up with the sale. But the sale doesn't stop here. We must stay engaged with the customer, return phone calls, and offer assistance and prospect referrals. Now, one thing that I always do before I ever, what I teach is before I ever ask for something, I always give something. Hey, Nick, just calling to let you know that you have a free oil change here. And if you give me a review, you get another free oil change. So I just want to let you know that. By the way, Nick, is there anybody in your church that you know that might be looking for a vehicle also? That's another thing that I like to do is I like to minimize the group of referrals, because if you just ask them, you know, who's looking for a car, they're thinking, I know 500 people. So they're like, I don't think Nick is. I don't think Anthony is. I don't know if Fran might be. They're looking at, but if you put it in, who on your kid's baseball team, what parents on your kid's baseball team might be looking for a vehicle? Who in your church might be looking for a vehicle? Have you seen anybody in your neighborhood that might be having car problems, right? That you saw the wrecker come by and jump the car the other day. Or you see it, minimize it, because even if it's not a parent on the kid's baseball team, my sister-in-law was talking about her lease is due on her Chrysler 300. Does she like that vehicle? No, she can't stand it. And the salesperson's not there anymore. She's had nothing but problems in service. So we want to minimize it. It makes it easier for the customer to it makes it easier for the customer to think of the referral. So the puppy dog is the sale. The loyal dog, now this is what we are all after. This is where the money's made. This is where everything's built. The sales are easy, and you sell three or four cars that day, and you're like, man, I don't even feel like I worked. You know, you're like, I remember my first month in the business. I was running around like crazy. I couldn't get anybody to say yes. And it's like, I don't even feel like I work. That's because we built up enough value in that customer that they give us their repeat business. They don't negotiate as hard. They don't shop around as much. And when they send us referrals, in fact, I had this when I was selling cars, and I sat where I could see outside. I could see the front door. I could see people coming from service, and I could see the whole showroom. And people are like, why don't you get one of the back suites? And I said, because my desk is perfect. Everybody knows where I sit, and I've got all the views I want. And to me, it wasn't about having the more prestigious desk. I wanted the view. But customers would come in, they would page me, I would walk up, and they'd be like, you're Noel Walsh? You know, like I was a celebrity, because the person that referred them to me built up my reputation and spoke so highly of me. I was like a celebrity in their mind. They're like, all Jack does at Bowling League is talk about you. You know, and he's like passing out your cards to everyone every week, and that's all he does, is because I built that up, right? That customer became addicted. There's 12 A's to influence in the 12 A's of sales, or the 12 A's of sales, the 12th A is addiction. And so we want to get that addicted customer to where they are truly addicted to dealing with us, the feeling we give them, and the, you know, just how we make that customer feel, how we make them feel comfortable, how we make them feel appreciated, how we remember stuff about what's important to them, that they're a golfer, that their kids play baseball, that their daughter's a dancer. No matter what it is, that we make them feel important by talking about what's important to them. We go follow up with them constantly by find out what their best way of contact is. Some people don't like to be texted, right? Some people don't ever check their email. Some people are on social media all the time, so that's a good place to hit them there. Some people like to talk on the phone, so find out how they like to be followed up with and follow up there. Another good thing, too, I learned from a salesperson, Bill Hab also. Everybody should be following him on social media. His name didn't come up. He does the dashboard diaries. He sells about 20 cars a month, all from Facebook. And what he does is when he sells somebody, he tags everybody in it, and he'll go in there into the, and he gets tons of views and tons of likes and tons of comments, and he'll go into the comments and say, hey, Shannon, by the way, I wanted you to know that you have a free oil change coming up, and he'll tag your name in it. So then that everybody on that thread sees that again, and their friends and neighbors see it, so you're just kind of keeping that alive. It's not just one post, and people weren't looking at social media that day, and it's gone. It keeps refreshing it, and it keeps refreshing it, and then people say, like, man, like, you know, Shannon's salesperson was, like, a really good guy. Like, he's still following up, like, a month later, letting her know that he's got a free set of floor mats, or wanting to schedule her free oil change. And so, you know, you're just refreshing that. Find out what they like to become the most. And when they're a service, go up and visit them. I'd let my service writers know. We had Reynolds and Reynolds. I know you do too, but we used Reynolds and Reynolds, and it would let us know. We would get Reynolds and Reynolds email, and it would let us know when our customer was in service. I'd always go out of my way. It was free coffee. Like, can I buy you a coffee? Sit with them for 10 or 15 minutes. Even if they just bought the car a week ago, 2 weeks ago, and they're going to complain, because guess what? I picked up so many sales because people are like, wow, they wanted somebody to come back and find them. We didn't work the service department at my dealership. This was probably the most effective way it was worked. But they would be like, wow, he's a nice guy. I would get one person a week that would, you know, come up, and they'd be like, hey, you know, by the way, I leased this car and we moved, or we're getting ready to trade in. We need a truck now because we bought a camper. And I wanted to test drive that new F-150. Do you have time? Because they saw that you were a real genuine person, so they saw that they wanted to deal with you. And it makes your customer feel good, too, because you're like, hey, I just got a notification that you're here on service. I just want to make, is everything okay? How are you enjoying the vehicle? Hey, when's your husband's lease due again? You know, didn't you say that your daughter's just about to turn 16? You know, I'm prospecting more leads and finding out what other sales are there. And I remember stuff about customers, horrible with names, remember stuff about customers, but if I didn't have a really good memory, I'd be taking notes too on a board, and so I would remember it, so I'd have ways to contact, knowing that Sally's going to turn 16 in 2 months, or that Mr. Jones's lease is coming due in 3 months. You know, I would make notes and know who my customers are and know where they're at in the buying process, because once again, we want that whole pack of dogs, right? We don't just want the husband, we don't just want the wife. We want the husband, we want the wife, we want the neighbors, we want the friends, we want the in-laws, and we want the kids as they start sprouting up. Now, when you're in the business for 16 years, thank you, when you're in the business for 16 years, you know, you start out and their kids are 2 and 4. Well, now they're 16 and 18, right? So those people, kind of like Fran talked about, those people, those kids, those little kids that were running around the showroom and knocking stuff off your desk, they become buyers. So we want to keep everybody engaged and know who's in the process and constantly ask questions. So when Sally turns 16, what are you guys thinking of? You thinking of a used vehicle? You thinking of, oh, yeah, $5,000 vehicle. Well, Mr. Taylor, have you looked at $5,000 vehicles? I've been looking at them online. What do you think of them? There isn't anything out there. I know. You know what, though? We've got a great deal on a Focus right now. And what you could do is she's just going to be driving back and forth to school. You've been complaining about gas prices. Her birthday's coming up in 2 months. We've got a $179 lease on a Focus right now. Low mileage, you could actually drive it to work for a couple months to offset your gas prices. And now you know she's in a vehicle with roadside assistance, full warranty. If anything happens, she can call an 800 number, and it's going to save you gas money. And you don't have to worry about her breaking down in school or driving to the football game across the county. You know that she's taken care of. So always think about and always strategize how you can get the next sale from every customer. And we want to do that with our loyal puppy dogs, right? Because if we're just constantly, I already switched, but if we're just constantly going after those stray cats, we're going to have that 10% retention of getting the appointment. And then when we finally get that appointment in, 23%, 25%, maybe if we're lucky, 30% close ratio. So we really want to focus on that pack of dogs that we have there and make them loyal. Ways to engage and keep engagement. So, you know, the buzzwords in the business, and I remember when I first started going to conferences, I'd hear engagement, engagement, engagement. I'm like, what does engagement mean? I got engaged with my wife 14 years ago. You know, what does engagement mean? And engagement is meaning like constantly staying in contact with that customer, continuously keep in touch and stay engaged with sold and unsold customers on a schedule. You know, have a schedule down, like Anthony talked about. This will keep you fresh in your customer's mind while providing you are a diligent professional, right? They see that you're a professional. They call 4 dealerships, they never even got a call back. We're going to call you right back with the price on that. They didn't even call them back. You're calling on a schedule. They appreciate that. They see that you're a diligent professional. They want to deal with you. And so use your CRM or have a monthly agenda. I think Fran might have some kind of schedule in his book. Some people are notebook people. CRM makes it all easy, you know, birthdays and everything right there. Some ways to stay engaged are birthdays and celebrations. Always a great reason to call, mail, and contact your customer in an unsolicited way, right? Like I was talking to Fran, and he'd be, yeah, my sister Judy, who you sold, they're having their 50th anniversary. Oh, really? I'm going to write that down when I go to my desk. I'm going to send them a happy anniversary. Or Shan would tell me, yeah, my brother just retired from GM. He's so excited. He's retiring in 6 weeks. Perfect. I'm gonna, congratulations on your retirement. You know, it gives you a reason to email, mail, call people, and it's unsolicited, right? Everybody likes getting a birthday card. Everybody likes getting a phone call on their birthday. Everybody likes to feel appreciated on their birthday. How many of us are like, thank you everyone for your Facebook likes and comments yesterday for my birthday. I appreciate. We all appreciate that, right? Everybody does. So birthdays and celebrations and any celebration, high school graduation, no matter what it is, gives you a reason to stay engaged with that customer. Phone and text, great ways to check up on the customer, add value, and that also gives you the opportunity to ask for surveys and reviews. Hey, by the way, it's your 3-month anniversary. I just wanted to make sure that you're still enjoying your Silverado. Wanted to know if you'd had any problems or you had any questions. If you do have any questions, Shannon, I invite you to come in because there are over 10,000 options on that vehicle. I know maybe a tenth of them. I've shared maybe a tenth of those with you, and you maybe remembered a tenth of those. So I'd be more than happy to set up an appointment around your schedule when you could come in. I'd like to kind of give you a refresher on the vehicle so you are utilizing all the options on the vehicle. Gifts away. By the way, Shannon, I noticed I haven't received a survey from you yet. Did you receive the link? Yeah, I just haven't got around to it yet. That's okay. That's understandable. I know I get way too many emails. Could you do me a favor and could you log on right now and see if you can still find that survey? Yeah, give me a minute. I got to boot up my computer. Oh, no rush. I mean, walk the customer through it. Whenever we give the customer something, that gives us the opportunity to ask the customer for something, right? When we give, it gives us the opportunity to ask. Because did everybody like it when people are just asking constantly? Will you do this for me? 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 Will you do? Nobody likes that. You know, so give, and then we ask for the get. And whether it's a review, whether it's a survey, every time we call that customer, we should give them something of value, even if it's something we've already given them, and then we should ask for something in return. Another way, social media. People love getting likes and comments on their posts and makes you visible to their network. Friend all your customers you can on social media. Friend all your customers that you can on social media. Try and go to their page, especially if you know their lease is coming due or something like that, or they just bought the vehicle. Because what are they going to do the first week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks after they bought the vehicle? They're going to talk about it. They're going to show it off, right? So stay engaged with them. Like their stuff. They post a picture of little Sally, you know, first day of preschool, or little Johnny. Stay engaged with that customer through social media. People like that. Everybody likes getting likes. Everybody likes getting comments. It makes you visible to their network. Email, some people like email, some people don't. I mean, I get so many emails, it's like a race. Anthony says race to the relationship. I'm like race to get the notification lights off, you know, burn through them as fast as I can. And, you know, all the ones I get every week, the MailChimp ones that are all automated, I just kind of fly through. But some people like constant emails. They can be annoying, but it keeps our name in the customer's mind, right? And it keeps our name, and even if we take a cover page of our website and forward that to them or whatever. Hey, just want to let you know we have some sales going on. If you have anything, any questions about your vehicle, please don't hesitate to call. If you have any questions, please feel free to call. And if you know of anybody looking, please let them know the same professional service that I gave you, I will also give them. I use that line all the time. I wanted you to know that I will give the same professional service to anybody you send me that I gave you. Is that fair enough? Yeah. No, you took really good care of us. And mail, customers will sift through their mail, and Fran talked about this too. I actually kind of learned this from Fran, but I used to just do the lick 'em and stick 'em, but I would start handwriting, and believe me, we get a stack of mail like this every day, and I don't even go through the mail anymore. My wife does. I always used to go through the mail, but if I saw something that was handwritten, I'm opening it, right? Because there's going to be an offer from Chase, offer from Capital One, offer from Delta Cards, there's going to be refinance this, there's going to be all that stuff I don't care about. But then I'm going to see something handwritten, I'm dying to see what's in there, right? I'm dying to see what's in there because everything else is generated. So mail still does work. Postcards are great. Postcards are a great way because the customers don't have to put in much effort. The guy who did our sprinkler system when we lived in Michigan, we have a gravel yard, now we're in the desert. But when we lived in Michigan, the guy who did our sprinklers, he'd send out a postcard every year, like in March. Well, in Michigan, you don't know if you're going to get freezing in May. But so I put that postcard there by the phone where we kept the mail, and then when I knew it was time, I'd say, hey, honey, give him a call. He made it easy. He stayed in front of me, right? Same thing with the customer. Their lease might be coming due. They're just going to keep that postcard somewhere so they remember you. It sticks out. Use the postcard. Thank you cards are great. I always send you a thank you for stopping in. Even if they're going to buy on Monday, and it was Saturday, and we closed up the deal, everything was done, but they had to get the little Johnny soccer game or little Sally dance recital, I still sent them a thank you for stopping in card that I knew they wouldn't get until Tuesday or Wednesday. And I would send these out to people that would badmouth me and say, you know, you guys have on your website that you'll get anybody approved and this and that and blah, blah, blah. I still send them a thank you for stopping in card. And I'd write the same message to everybody. And it would be a nice message, too, that, you know, if you know of anybody looking, please send them my way. I'm sorry things didn't work out. If anything changes on my end, I will get in touch with you. And if you could do me a favor, if anything changes on your end, get in touch with me. Believe me, I'm 100% commissioned, so if it's up to me, everybody's approved, everybody gets 0% for 10 years, and every price is under $10,000. But unfortunately, I don't make the rules, and there's probably a reason why. So, one of my quotes here, if you're not engaging with your customers after the sale, you're losing traction. Once again, we sell them and we forget about them, right? We're chasing after that next stray cat. We're just running down the street. We're chasing after them. We don't realize we have the most profitable source of customer that we just sold, and we aren't engaging them. We're spending more effort chasing after new business rather than just giving them the extra attention every month, follow-up calls, letters, social media, all that. Stay engaged. Story is, we bought a camper about a year and a half ago at the Ford dealership in the town I live in, and we bought the camper, we bought it used. He was a nice guy. We bought him on Valentine's Day, and we bought it at like 8 o'clock at night. Everybody in there was rushing, right? We all have dates with our wives, you know, and we've been hiking all day, so I'm like a sleeveless shirt, all dirty, hair's all messed up and everything. And so the salesperson was a really nice guy. It was a quick process. They let me take it, me and my dad, took it for like a 20-minute drive because I wanted to make sure our Explorer would pull it. And so then we needed to get some work done on our Explorer, and so I said, I'm going to take it into the dealership. I'm going to let them know about the service that I provide. And I go, honey, by the way, who is our salesperson? And she goes, I don't know. I go, he was that Latino kid. He was real nice. I think his name was David, but I can't remember his name. She's like, I don't know. I go, do we ever get mail from him? She said, no, we never get anything. I got like a thank you for buying letter, like generated from the dealership like 2 weeks later, and I think I got an email, like fill out a survey for us, right? So it's like a generated letter I got and emailed that says, fill out this survey for us, right? No value for you. Fill out this survey for us. You just spent this money. Now we want something else from you. So I went in, and the kid was still there, and his name was David, and I still can't remember his last name, but I'm like, bro, you know, you got to stay in touch, because if I was the average customer, that's how you get that salesperson who's like, hey, that was my customer. And it's like, no, they weren't your customer, because you didn't keep in touch. I didn't even remember your name. And so, you know, that's what we need to do, is we need to stay engaged with those customers and let them know who we are, stay fresh in their mind, or else they're going to forget us, and then that's how there's the fist fights and the yelling on the showroom, everybody running up to the boss, that was my customer, and it wasn't because your customer didn't ask for you because you didn't stay in touch with them. So, how it works selling cats and retaining dogs, the customer inquires, right? We said we utilize the first contact, we set up enough value to bring the customer in, the appointment shows, we have everything ready. We have the vehicle pulled up, we make sure it's got gas, we make sure it starts, we make sure we have the key, we are prepared, and then we sell the customer, and so, you know, when they come in, we know that they're serious, they drive the product, guess what, they're serious, it's time to make a sale. I'm getting low on time here, so I'll keep it. Another thing, reason, so I sold cars in Michigan and moved to Utah, right? So I moved to St. George, Utah from Ann Arbor, Michigan. 2,000-mile move. I still sold cars for 20 months, right? I moved in September of 2014, and I last day of selling was March 1st of this year. And I was still selling 15 to 25 cars, and I made as much last year in 2015, working 25 weeks, as I made when I was the number one salesman at the number 3-4 dealership in the nation when I said I couldn't make any more money, right? And I made that same amount of money in 2015, working 25 weeks, 2,000 miles from home, getting on an airplane, flying the red eye, having the drivers pick me up at the airport, getting in the office and pounding the phones. One of the reasons I did that is I lease my customers. And so many people are afraid of leasing. I know some states aren't lease friendly, and I do have a slideshow I can send you all. But on this little graph right here, in 121 months, a customer will spend $40,000 on a lease and $60,000 on a buy. And that's just in payments. That's not to mention maintenance and everything that goes along with it. So when your customer says that leasing is a ripoff, leasing is a waste of money, you don't own the car when you lease. How many of your sales of your customers trade in a paid off vehicle? 5%, 10%? They never own their vehicle, right? They never. And when they do, they pay this car off for 6 years. They put $4,000 in maintenance. And it's worth what, $3,000, $4,000? Mm-hmm. Well, guess what? On a 2-year lease, they save $200 a month. It doesn't take rocket science. 200 times 24 months is 4,800. That's your equity right there in leasing, plus the money you save your maintenance cost. Revenue model, the stray cat, we turn it into a house cat. The appointment, the puppy dog is the sale. The loyal dog is the customer that we get repeat and referral business off of. That goes with consumer, sale, repeats and referrals. That's how we want to do that one right there. And once again, Noel Walsh, NWNA, Conquer What You Chase. If anybody has any questions, I don't know if we want to do questions now or we want to do questions in a moment. Anybody have any questions? Somebody does. Come on, be that first person. After that, they're like firecrackers.
I know all this stuff.
Well, cool. Well, everybody, I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Fran.
All right.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Anthony.